Welcome back to Lanterne Rouge Cycling Podcast, presented by Zwift for the La Vuelta, España. 2022 starts hot on the heels of the Tour de France Flamme Avec Zwift LR here with Benji, as always, for a TTT. We haven't had one for I don't know how long, since the Watergate, when Jumbo Visma and UAE crashed and the water slippery slide that burst down the hill. Was that the last one in a Grand Tour? I can't remember. Was it that long ago? 3 years ago. Anyway, Benji's going to refresh us, update us on the rules in a second. We'll read out the results, say what does this mean for GC. Big gaps already. And yeah, it's interesting to see these huge gaps. We'll get to that in a second. Before we do, though, Zwift Academy is back for 2022 and registration is open now. Whether you're aiming for a pro contract like Jay Vine, who we saw in the Alpecin-De Koenig squad here today, or Neve Bradbury, who just got some good GC results recently, actually, or you're just looking to kickstart your fitness with some structured sessions, Zwift Academy will help you to get fitter and have more fun on the bike. There are 6 workouts to complete, either solo or in group workouts with baseline rides to compare your progress before and after Zwift Academy. During the Vuelta, I'll be Zwifting for every single stage, including rest days, hashtag no days off. I've got to catch up to Benji's weight loss progress.
Good luck.
He's flying this year. I don't think it's possible at this point for me to catch up. But yeah, Zwifting, a Zwift session for every stage of the Vuelta and rest days for me coming up. But Benji, TTTs, refresh us on the rules, please.
Yes, certainly. It's been a while since we had some, so let's refresh you on what they actually are. So a team time trial, the concept is simple. Teams go over the starting wrap every few minutes, and they basically do a time trial, but with the team itself. In a Grand Tour, we've got 8 riders, and it has an effect because in a normal stage race, we've got 7 riders. The team's result is the time set by the 5th rider to cross the line if they start with 8 riders, so in a Grand Tour, that is the case, which means that everyone finishing in the same group as that 5th rider gets the same time as that 5th rider. So let's say Remco Evenepoel finishes first of Quickstep in a group of 7 riders. The time of that 5th rider crossing the line counts, not Evenepoel who finished first in that group of 7, for example, not the 7th rider crossing the line because he was in the same group as the 5th rider, he gets the same time. Now, the caveat is, let's say you're dropped by the 5th rider who crossed the line and you cross the line 3 seconds later, you actually lose that time. So that's a significant aspect here. You got to make sure that you stick with the 5th rider, otherwise you lose time. And that's where certain teams might have interesting concepts. If they have like 4 leaders, they got to make sure that those 4 leaders are within the group of the 5th rider to make sure that they don't lose time compared to their own team crossing the line in the first place. So that's where it gets intriguing. That's where the concept of team time trials is at when it comes to the rules. When it comes to the actual like team time trialing itself, the concept is simple. The draft of being in the wheel of other riders, make sure that you have less drag resistance. And as a consequence, you go faster as a group and you spend less energy in the wheel of the riders ahead of you.
We'll talk about Quickstep.
Yeah. And there's also the small effect. I think Bert Blokken made a good research on this back in the day, that if you're, for example, behind the rider ahead of you gets, I think it was almost 3% advantage from the upstream effect. That's why in like individual time trials, you often see a car with like tons of bikes on top, because that actually gives a bonus to the rider that is riding ahead of the car. That's the same in team time trials. You also get a bonus from riding ahead of riders, apparently. So yeah, there's a lot of riding ahead and behind each other. The concept is simple. The fastest team across the parkour wins the team time trial, at least when it comes to their 5th rider.
And the question was, which teams would they try and finish with a full complement of 8 riders, 7 riders, 6 riders, 5 riders? Would they drop riders off? And we'll see teams did different things, maybe intentionally or unintentionally. It was a 23-kilometer course around Utrecht. We said in the preview that obviously it starts in the Netherlands. It was technical, pretty technical in the last 6Ks, but still fast. And the Dutch team came out swinging in their home. I don't know what Grand Départ is in Spanish. Don't know what it is in Dutch either. Jumbo Visma winning with an average speed of 56.6, which is 0.5 kilometers an hour quicker than the Ineos Grenadiers, 13 seconds behind on a time of 24.40 for Jumbo, 24.53 for Ineos. Jumbo were about 14 seconds up at T1.
Yeah.
Well, there's the T1 to Ineos, so they lost a second in the last little bit. Ineos were a best part of a second. They've been credited with a full second over Quickstep. I think that's a good time from Quickstep, over 56 k's an hour. And Bike Exchange were fourth. So I think it was in order of the bookies' favourites, except for Ineos and being a little bit better than the bookies thought. Bike Exchange fourth on 31. They went a bit earlier because Ineos, Quickstep, Jumbo-Visma, Movistar, they went off, I think, in order of their GC last year in the Vuelta. And the course dried up a bit, at least that's from what I could see. There's like,
yeah.
Kern Farmer, I'm sure, did a nice job. Maybe I'm being a bit harsh, but
You're being harsh. It's the one team that was literally in the middle of the parkour that... I disagree with you on this. This is like, red flag between us right now. You don't think the weather change
helped Kern Farmer?
Kern Farmer was legendary today.
Who's the bloke with the helmet?
I've got absolutely no clue.
Spanish champ. He's probably you.
Raul Garcia Pierna, the guy that's going to win the stage this year, apparently, he's your according man. To me.
Anyway, we'll see. They actually did a pretty good time. I should go through actually and do the full complement of in terms of the GC teams. UAE lost 33. FDJ 38, Bora 41, Trek 42, Bahrain 42, Movistar 43, Astana 46. So the sort of you can throw a blanket over Bora, Trek, Bahrain, Movistar. There's a second and a half between all of them. DSM 53, that's not great actually for a Dutch team with some bigger riders in it. Asia 2R 55 with O'Connor. Alpes and De Koenig 103. EF lost 119 for Uran, Chavez, and Carthy. Intermarché 125. That's it from the GC teams. A lot on Cofidis. Doesn't really matter. So Jumbo do the job. They let Robert Hessink cross the line first. He'll take the red jersey, the 36-year-old long-tenured veteran of Jumbo Visma. Nice to see that. Roglic came in second, so we will have Froglic in the green jersey tomorrow. So I bet you, I haven't seen any interviews yet. We record straight after. 100%. He'll be smiling when they ask him about the green jersey. He's got that, I'm a sprinter joke teed up. I guarantee it. He's got it teed up and he'll let that one rip. So can't wait to see Froglic in the green jersey. Harper takes polka dots. Don't know why. I assume because order of precedence, and because Jumbo have no young riders, Hayter takes white jersey. So what, any surprises for you, Benji? No huge upsets, no crashes, which is good. I think it kind of all played out pretty standard.
But while I expected the first four teams to be the best teams on the road, I expected the gaps to be less, because the gaps between Jumbo Visma and Bike Exchange in fourth is 31 seconds. That's a lot. And I did not expect to be seeing a gap like that between four teams that we considered having a chance at winning this team time trial. I considered Jumbo Visma a strong team time trial team, but I wasn't expecting them to win this by 13 seconds on Ineos, 14 seconds on Quickstep. That's seems like a lot to me personally. Am I wrong in that?
It's a lot. Like 30 seconds on this parkour. Like, I don't know how long we spent in the preview, which, I mean, go back and listen to it if you haven't listened to it yet. But we spent so much time on this preview, talking about how the third week parkour is really gentle for a grand tour. And like 30 seconds on some of those mountaintop finishes? Like, where are you going to find 30 seconds? Particularly if Roglic is in good shape. Like, these are huge gaps, 30 to UAE.
Exactly. That's like to those teams. But then we talk about an Aja Desert with O'Connor. That's already on a minute. When we talk about EF, if we consider Charles as a GC rider, that's a lot of time, eh?
Plus a TT to come.
Exactly. So those riders are like, it also the factor that the riders that are on these team time trial teams are also the riders, like you say, that are also good at the ITTs themselves. So they're going to gain more time in that individual time trial. And as a consequence, that's going to have a huge effect. But then again, there's also the opposite. Roglic, for example, was an example of what I just said. A good time trialist that will have a good individual time trial on the team of Jumbo, who had a good team time trial. There's also Sepp Kuss, who had a good team time trial on the team of Jumbo-Visma. but was spending the entire time trial at the back. And when it comes to his ITT that's coming in this Vuelta, it likely will not be near Roglic and Zofov. He will lose time in that individual time trial. So, by the way, what's your thoughts on their strategy when it comes to Sepkus in this team time trial?
So Ineos and Jumbo, the two best teams, they both tried to get their full complement of riders to the finish. There was no, I thought there might be some magic sauce about, by the way, Bigham, who broke the hour record today, the UCI hour record, also the guy that I presume designs everything, is consultant for Ineos, their TTT strategy and TT strategy. I thought they'd be like, okay, so you have Turner pull the first half to exhaustion, then Turner drops off. They didn't do any of that. Same with Jumbo. They kept their full complement. And I think it's pretty smart for Jumbo Visma with Kuss, like, to hang at the back. Kuss handling on the TT bike is quite good. We've seen in short technical prologues, he's actually done well, and that's not on absolute power. But in a 65, 70K an hour straight, you want a Feeney, Turnison, Dennis on the front. You don't want Kuss on the front. And even Hessink's competent time trials and a bigger guy too, giving a good draft. So it's interesting that, like, the guys who are so good at TT, like a Jonas or a Remco or even a Roglic, are they that helpful in a team time trial? Now, Roglic is not a negative in it, and Remco isn't either, but they're so good because they're little pocket rockets. They're super aerodynamic. They don't provide much draft behind them. Yeah. So what did you make of, I think Quickstep overperformed today. I thought Ineos had a much better team. If you look like Turner, Plap, Hayter, overall a better time trialing team than Quickstep. I think Quickstep did well, but what did you think of Remco darting out at the end? Was that nervousness, anxiety, had a lot left in the tank? Because Hayter did something similar for Ineos.
I think when it comes to Quickstep, indeed, Remco moved up towards the end and had a bit of a gap on the others because, I don't know, did they get information across the parkour that Jumbo was beating them at the individual time check beforehand, the intermediate time check, not the individual one, it's a team time trial, at the intermediate check number one, Jumbo was beating Quickstep. Did Remco hear that then kind of like panic of like, oh, we're going too slow, I got to speed up towards the end, got to try and close down as much as possible towards Roglic, but that's not going to work out because I think Alaphilippe was sitting behind Remco and then asked Seri to slot in front of Alaphilippe and Seri couldn't hold the wheel of Remco in the last section and that's when a gap gets created and Remco basically finishes a bit before his team and it's a time of the fifth rider that counts. So
it doesn't
whether
help.
Remco does that or not, it's irrelevant. Like, it's completely irrelevant. And him being closer to his team, probably, it's only like a tiny bit, but probably helps the team itself be a bit closer towards the time of Ineos and Jumbo, but I don't think that would have moved the significant needle in this question, but it matters in the grand scheme of things, and that's something we see on this team, and I'd like to point the opposite on other teams. I want to talk about Bora as well for a bit.
Yeah, that's Bora, the other one.
Bora is a team here that spent a lot of their riders initially because Sam Bennett isn't going to do much in the team time trial, let's be honest about it, and they ended up being with five riders left with
good
two points. That's true. Good first time check. Five riders left with 2.7 kilometers to go, which is early compared to the other teams. The question then is, did they burn their other three riders so quickly that those other five have so much workload to do in the last section? Because the last time was they lost more in the second half than they did in the first half.
And yeah, who were two of their last five? Igita, Hindley, they weigh a combined 110 kilos. So that's the problem as well, the components of your last five. And yeah, I think Quickstep, Benji, I don't think it all went to plan in the last section, the way Seri, Alaphilippe, I think Remco kind of cooked Alaphilippe in the wheel a little bit. I don't think it all went to plan. But yeah, it's, I really like team time trials and I think it's, it rewards overall team coordination, obviously, and planning. Yes, it does help the richer teams in theory because they can have better equipment. They can afford better, you know, better riders throughout.
And research. Better research.
Yeah.
Wind tunnels everywhere.
Exactly. I think that still matters a lot. Like them. I still like team time trials. At least one a year, I think, is good. If I had to say who was a big winner or a big loser of today, maybe kind of everyone else apart from the top three, really. Like, it's such big gaps. Maybe it won't be in the end. But, yeah, is there anything else that stood out to you? I'd say that Evenepoel is, like, the most tanned Belgian person I've ever seen. He's clearly showing off that he's been in Xavier in 40 degrees for a month. He looks in good shape. I think Roglic looked in fine shape for the TT. Did you think UAE would do a little better? Because actually their team on paper, Oliveira, McNulty, Soler, Milano, Ackerman, Ayuso, Almeida, it's actually a pretty good time trial team. They'll be probably sad to have lost the best part of 20 to Ineos and Quickstep.
Yeah, but I'd argue that I wasn't expecting that team to be part of those first four that we mentioned earlier, the Jumbo, Ineos, Quickstep, bike exchanges of this world. I expected UAE to be worse at a team time trial than those four teams. I don't know about the research of each individual team into team time trials. I know that Quickstep trains them quite a bit. I know that Jumbo Visma has some in-depth analysis on that because I spoke about it earlier, the Baird blocking guy that had the research on the draft resistance and so forth within team time trials. He wrote an entire piece on it. This guy is doing stuff for Jumbo Visma in the wind tunnels and so forth. So he does work for them. So I'm guessing that they do quite a bit of work on team time trials as well, compared to, for example, an Ager Desert, which I wouldn't expect to do as much for team time trials. I think an Ineos would probably do quite a bit of work on them, like you said, with Dan Bigham and the rest of the squad there. Bike Exchange has Marco Pinotti, who was partially an architect of the BMC team time trials back in the day when they were dominating. So that's a factor there. Who is that person at UAE?
Quickstep drill it a lot, but I don't think they had the horses today. They did have the Darth Vader helmets that Lampard refused to wear. They do practice. I think practice is important. They practice a lot, and have, you know, quick equipment. But I agree, it's impossible to know. Like, staff movements and which teams have which staff is probably the most underrated part of cycling.
I think Groupama went to one. I don't know if it was an F1 track or something to train in France somewhere. So they trained for it. They also have a decent time, better than I expected, to be honest, with the squad they have here. Sixth time, and that's only 5 seconds behind UAE, but that's a significant time on Jumbo, like 38 seconds. But it's better than I would have expected. I expected Trek to beat them, for example, or a Bora to beat them, for example. But Bora fell through towards the end, like we mentioned. Now, other teams like... It's obvious that Alotto will not be going for this team time trial, and arguably them losing time is better for the breakaways that are coming up in this race. So
yeah, no sprint, no GC guy. Mate, De Gent will be on 12 minutes when they go back to Spain, which he should. No, he should. Like, that's a smart thing to do. I don't know how FDJ set such a good time with Bruno Amarell on the team, who apparently, I think the team said he wasn't able to ride on the flat, so that's why he didn't go to the Tour de France, but magically...
That's BS.
Magically, he's the French national time trial champion and part of a really good performance from there. But yeah, it's huge gaps. But for the rest of the stages in the Netherlands, we have the first Cat 4 tomorrow, so there'll be a breakaway fight for the Alto de... Why is this in fucking Spanish on the profile?
Alto de Amarones, my friends.
Why is this climb in Hertogenbosch in Spanish? It's a sprint stage tomorrow in the Netherlands, 176Ks. I'm completely flabbergasted. It's 1 point available. I think that means like they get no points for the KOM in the TTT. So that'll be taking it off Harper. That'll be a breakaway battle. Look to see, I think, Intermarché getting in the break. They're not Dutch, but they'll... Dutch speaking team, or are they Wallonie team? I don't know. They're from Belgium. And the Spanish Pro Conti team's going for that. And then it's going to be a sprint. Merlier will be the favorite on Alpecin de Koenig. I think he will probably get the job done. I mean, let me look at his lead out. I do worry about Merlier without a lead out.
Yep.
He's got no lead out pretty much. Just Vermeersch, Tamino, Janssens, no De Bont. No, Rickard, does that worry you, Benji? Because the team wasn't confirmed when we did the preview.
It does worry me personally. And I don't know what to expect, really. I do think that Vermeersch can set up a decent lead out, to be honest. I think that the likes of a Jimmy Janssens can play a role in like the early role in the lead out, but when it comes to the last part of it, I doubt it. So I think Johnny Vermeer should just pilot Melier to the final and try and do a sprint like that, because otherwise I'm not sure I can see there. Do you think Rob Stannard, he's punchy? Do you think he's also low-key decent in lead outing or not?
I've never really seen it or focused on it. I'm not sure. I mean, in theory, maybe third, fourth, last man. This is the Vuelta after all. This isn't Tour de France sprints trains, although those didn't exist in this Tour de France. Trek have Danul, Tiberi, Kirsch for Pedersen. That's not too bad. I would say Bike Exchange have the overall strongest train, but they do not have the best last man, which is obviously Danny van Poppel. So Bora probably have the most balanced lead out with Koch, Mullen, Van Poppel for Bennett, probably best overall one, although Bike Exchange in terms of setup is the best with O'Brien, Durbridge, Craddock, and Hepburn for Groves, but they're missing a Mezgetz. They're missing the last man. So if I was Merlier or Danny Van Poppel, I would slot myself on the Bike Exchange train, and then when it comes to 500 meters to go, punch past them. That would be my strategy. So I don't know. I don't know who wins, Benji. Can you see Bennett winning? He'll get a good lead out.
Has to be Merlier. I'm sorry. Because the reason that I'm going for Merlier is that he's going to try and get stage wins in the Netherlands, and then he should dip out of La Vuelta and just go home and have a nap, because there's not that many opportunities afterwards. Save the carbon credits. You're right.
Anyway, that was the TTT. Let us know who you think is winning. We're going to do an impromptu transfers roundup part two, Carapaz, Kelderman, Van Baal, during the day tomorrow, because we are on just an unbelievable grind right now. And then we'll talk about the sprint stage afterwards. What did you think about the TTT? Do you think Roglic, it's already over? I must admit, I'm a little bit nervous about the Remco shout, Benji. I've seen 23 minutes of cycling, and I'm already terrified of Froglich. I'm not feeling good. It's not looking good, bruv. That's all from us, and we'll see you at the sprint recap tomorrow. Ciao.